Welcome to your tuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospheric physics in relation to weather and KLY mate. Have you ever heard of the virtual cash flow investment? Or do you know anything about pyramid setting? But you might react, what have this idea has anything to do with weather and KLY mate? Well, you will see how such seemingly remote ideas can be identified in the state-of-the-art global energy budget, which has been built at billions and billions of US dollars over the past 70 years by humans. Are you ready? Let's go and have fun. This is the global energy budget diagram, updated by UN organization from time to time to convince humans that several trace gases in the atmosphere, such as the plant's food and ox fat, can both stabilize and destroy this planet called Earth. All of the numbers in this diagram represent radiation intensity or heat flux are in unit watt per meter square, so I will only use the numbers in this talk. To help you to understand this diagram, which is full of magical but visible numbers, I would like to separate the atmosphere and the condensed matter surface, including land and oceans, like this. In fact, this was exactly what Arrhenius did in 1896 when he tried to work out a model to explain how CO2 might act as a control loop, either to make the Earth go back to another ice age or warm up his motherland by 4 degrees or so. Let's have a close look at the top of the atmosphere first. You can use primary school arithmetic to work out the net energy flow, or cash flow, if you like, is 340 minus 101 minus 239 equal to zero. If you assume the outer space is a bank and the planet is you, then you could argue your account is in balance. But the two-way cash flow is irrelevant. Now, let's focus on this gap of the vacuum between the surface and the atmosphere. You can see one big arrow upward, which denotes the assumed surface infrared radiation at 390, and a downward arrow that represents the back infrared radiation, 333. Calculated based on greenhouse effect hypothesis. As a result, the net infrared radiation from the surface is just 57. This is similar to pay your mortgage for a house by partially using your rental income, isn't it? Not quite, because the back radiation is generated by using the upward surface radiation. If you were a surface and the atmosphere is a payee, would you pay more than what you owed to a stranger and expect this person will pay you back somehow? Perhaps someone might argue, what's wrong with this? This is how we overpay our tax and obtain certain amount of return at the end of the financial year. But don't forget, heat is not digital currency. It is driven by temperature difference between two places. To be exact, who will pay the operation cost to driving energy flow? Do you think it is free of work to transport heat from a cold object to a hot one? Well, one might think of those virtual cash flow schemes in which an investor gets more money than his or her initial investment from newcomers. Think about it and think it again. These appear the most absurd part of the G-house effect hypothesis. If the back radiation from those trace gases is as strong as the solar radiation at the top of the atmosphere, as shown in this diagram, why don't people design a thermal engine to harvest or harness the back radiation near the surface day and night? This could solve humans' energy supply problems once for all. Unfortunately, such a back infrared radiation by the imagined greenhouse in the atmosphere is imagined too. Although many well-trained physicists and meteorologists have based their endorsement on this hypothesis since 1896 from both sides of the Senate debate in human history. As far as the balance sheet is concerned in this diagram, the total thermal energy budget is about 521, according to Dr. Hardy, including the 239 shortwave radiation from the sun, 390 infrared radiation from the surface, and the 108 non-radiation deficit. In other words, the Treasury of the Republic of Atmosphere can spend its energy at 521 every moment. But the question is, who will make the decision to redistribute the energy? Common sense tells us it depends on whether the government is democratically elected or not. Besides, whether Republic of Atmosphere adopts the capitalist free market economy or socialist with Chinese characteristics economy. Well, in history, the decision based on my independent investigation so far was first made by Arrhenius in 1896, who argued that the upward infrared radiation should be equal to the downward infrared radiation, or commonly called a back radiation. Equality for all. Legality? Two. We may say Arrhenius' assumption is politically correct, but thermodynamically wrong, because as you can see here, the surface underneath is much hotter than the outer space. Gradually, nevertheless, the community of the motherhood has abolished such an equality by introducing a f-factor. F fraction. This fraction is for the proportion of the back radiation. Now is closer to 63%. This implies the upward infrared radiation is just 37%. Think about it. How it could be justified? By the way, the two percentages are very close to the voting results in Australia several days ago for an outrageous referendum. I know this F factor well because I had read the recent papers by Dr. Hardy, who also believe in G-house effect. But he is a gentleman who spent hours in carefully polishing my paper draft 2 years ago. In summary, the global energy budget promoted by the IPCC is not based on natural law. Instead, it is driven by demand. In particular, the downward or back infrared radiation by the trace gases is not real, simply because it cannot be cashed out. Thank you for watching. Thank you for making comments and donation. See you next time.